bullwhip effect in supply chains, mitigating strategies. There are several strategies that we can employ in order to reduce the bullwhip effect or even eliminate it completely. And the first one is sharing information and intentions. So the idea is that the first idea is that the upstream stages in the supply chain should have information about demand at the lowest stage of the supply chain, right? If you share, for example, retailer shares information about the actual sales to consumers, then and shares this with distributors, shares it with a manufacturer, then these higher stages in the supply chain can actually have better forecasts, right? Because they update it with the same raw data. The retailers should also share actions on products, such as, you know, pricing changes, promotions, advertising, you know, merchandising, or assortment planning with the suppliers, so that the suppliers know, you know, which products might experience increased demand due to some of those actions, right? If you run a promotion, there will be an increase in demand. If you don't have a promotion this time and you used to have it, then there will be a lower demand than before, and so on. But information sharing should actually go both ways. For example, the suppliers might need to share information about upcoming capacity or perhaps a shortage of capacity, right, with retailers, so that retailers can actually synchronize their actions, knowing that, right, for example, if they run a promotion for something that we expect a shortage, that's not going to be a good idea. So this process of sharing of information and intentions and kind of joint planning and forecasting and replenishment is often called collaborative planning, forecasting and replenishment, or CPFR for short. The second strategy we can use in order to reduce the bullwhip effect and its negative consequences is to smoothen the flow of the product. And that can be done by trying to replenish inventory more frequently and in smaller batches. Right, so of course we have to work on reducing fixed costs of ordering. We have to work on simplifying the process of ordering so that smaller batches can be processed without a lot of effort. Also, you know, a good idea is to use electronic data interchange, which is this idea of exchanging order information and processing between supplier and consumer through computerized systems in an automated way with minimal or no involvement from humans. That speeds it up and makes it cheaper. Of course, transportation and handling costs can conflict with smaller batches, right? Because full truck loads are more efficient than partial loads, because pallets are cheaper to handle than boxes or, you know, smaller quantities. Right, but of course we have to try and reduce those transportation costs in order to achieve smaller batches. And one way to do that is through some consolidation. For example, if we didn't have a distributor, but we decide to create a distributor, right? A distributor can help us combine or consolidate, let's say for a retail network, consolidate orders from different suppliers, right, where these deliveries are in large quantities from each supplier, you know, maybe large pallets or you know, larger quantities, and then the deliveries from the distributor to retailers will be much smaller quantities, but because they are in a mix from different suppliers, we can still fill up full truckloads. The third strategy to reduce the bullwhip effect is eliminating pathological incentives. So as we said, trade promotions cause forward buying and that increases the bullwhip effect. So the obvious thing is try to avoid trade promotions if you can, of course, and instead use constant wholesale price. Of course, this might be difficult in some industries, some types of products where trade promotions are expected, but from the perspective of supply chain management, and the bullwhip effect, the trade promotions should be avoided. Another idea is to restrict returns and order cancellations. Generous return and cancellation policies allow customers to order more than they really need because they can always return or cancel even orders later on. So, of course, that increases the bullwhip effect. And if we restrict returns or order cancellations, we might have a reduced bullwhip effect. As for rationing during shortages, ration based on past sales, not current orders. Current orders can be inflated. Past sales are actual, much closer to the actual demand, and you can ration based on them. It's much better. And also avoid quantity discounts, which are, incentives to order much more in a single order. It's actually better to give discounts, if you have to give discounts, based on annual sales volume, not the order size. Because you see, actually, this is the right way to think about discounts. If you want to reward a company, you reward them for increasing the flow rate, right? Annual sales volume is something like a measure of a long-term flow rate, which is actually something that generates revenues for you, for the supplier. So it's better that you give a discount. Some companies give discounts, for example, retroactively on all the orders throughout the year, the moment a company, a customer achieves a certain quota. And it's better like this because the point is not to maximize the size of the order. You want to maximize how much in total per year you sell through a customer. A lot of the strategies that try to reduce the bullwhip effect fall under what is called currently a vendor-managed inventory, or VMI. This is an approach used first by Procter & Gamble when they cooperated with Walmart. Now it is actually used by many companies. The idea is that the retailer no longer decides when and how much inventory to order. It's the supplier that is in control, right? And actually, approaches differ because in some cases, the supplier can control just the warehouse inventory, but sometimes the supplier can actually control all the way to the retail shelves. Of course, for this approach to work, the retailer must share demand data with the supplier. It could be that they share, for example, the withdrawals from a distribution center or a warehouse, but it's even better when they share the point of sales data, for short POS, right? If they do that, then the supplier knows the actual consumer demand, not some orders from the retailer or network. And of course, this can be used as input to some automated replenishment system of the supplier. But the main thing is, of course, that the supplier manages inventory of the customer retailer network, for example. Of course, the retailer has to, in addition to demand, has to share also other actions related to the supplier's products, for example, the promotions or price changes and so on. The disadvantage of using vendor-managed inventory is, of course, that there is no opportunity for the customer, for the retailer, let's say, to benefit from trade promotions. And this might be seen as a disadvantage if trade promotions are a standard approach in a certain industry, that may discourage some retailers to join this kind of vendor managed inventory program. However, a supplier can offer a stable low price when someone agrees to manage inventory in that way, in that way, compensate the retailer for losing the opportunity to forward buy during a promotion period. So vendor-managed inventory has many benefits. It reduces order synchronization because now the supplier decides the time to replenish. It reduces order batching because supplier has more control on how to fill trucks with maybe smaller product lots. If the supplier notices that, let's say, full pallet deliveries are too much, maybe the supplier will decide to combine maybe two products into one pallet, half-half, and therefore reduce the quantities and deliver more frequently. A supplier can also combine orders from multiple retailers into one truck when, for example, two or more retailers are located near each other, and then the supplier can fill trucks by that improving economies of scale while still delivering smaller than full truckloads to those retailers. It also reduces overreaction, right? Supplier is less likely to overreact to increased sales than retailer, maybe because they have better visibility, they might see demands in many retailers. Overall, the biggest benefit is, of course, that it can reduce inventory levels in general, and at the same time, it can increase service levels measured by, for example, in-stock probability or fill rate.